Hi from the GRIO. I'm your co-host, Dr. Christina Greer. And here at What's In It For Us, we are excited to celebrate LGBTQ plus Pride Month. For the entire month of June, we will be featuring brilliant guest co-hosts from the LGBTQ plus community. And today we have a special guest co-host.
I am Pat Brown, comedian, writer, and a stand-up comic. And you're listening to What's In It For Us.
So today, I want us to talk about two things. One, the Pulitzer that was given to Darnella Frazier, who filmed George Floyd's murder. And two, the two Black students who won school honors, valedictorian and salutatorian. And then shortly after that, they were called for a recount, and two white students were also allowed to share those two titles. Give me some of your quick thoughts on those two topics.
The Darnella Frazier thing, I really actually think about her when I think about her in the way that I think about Ruby Bridges, in terms of how we can't protect our children from the trauma that this white systematic world is imparting on them. And it just feels like I'm sad by it. And they keep calling her a hero, but that's trauma to watch a man die like that.
I can't wait to get into that with you. So that and so much else we'll talk about in this week's episode of What's In It For Us. Okay, Pat, I wanted to talk about something that was on our timeline this week, which is Megan Thee Stallion's newest video, Thot Sh. Now listen, whenever her videos come out, I feel older, because I find myself clutching my pearls, right? I think that what she is doing is so fascinating and subversive and direct and beautiful for Black women. But I gotta say, a part of me is always like, whew, oh my, this is a lot for me to digest. So for those of you who haven't seen it, the Houston rapper dropped a video on Thursday for her new single, Thot Sh. It takes aim though at essentially Republican critics, and probably some Democrats too, and their sort of hypocritical outrage with her and her music and how she dresses and how she expresses herself, essentially saying that she's too vulgar. And she's basically like, watch your step and watch your mouth, because the women that you're stepping on are basically everyone you depend on. So walk me through your initial thoughts on watching this video and Megan Thee Stallion's place in society, I guess, right now, as we have these complicated questions about Black women and body image and where we're supposed to be and how we're supposed to act and politics of respectability and all that stuff.
When I watch the video, I kind of feel those, the pullings of respectability, because I was raised at a time where, you know, women, especially Black women, you were supposed to be this code of conduct that you always had to adhere to all the time. But I feel like I'm pushing against that with all these new rappers that are coming out. I actually love that they're so free. And I feel like also too, this is the opportunity for women, Black women, women of color, to be able to make money, and you don't have a lot of education or you don't have a lot of privilege. Stripping is one of the ways that women could make money and make a lot of money, and either use that to, you know, take care of your family or to go to school or what have you. But those, we have so many limited options for how women can have opportunities to make a lot of money for themselves. And of course, it's not, you know, it's a hard work. It's probably humiliating in a lot of ways and whatever, but there is a opportunity. And I feel like she and Cardi have done that. They actually are the American dream. They have pulled themselves up by their bootstraps or by their clear stilettos, and they've made themselves millionaires. They made themselves millionaires twice over. And what does our society always says? Use your ingenuity. Didn't they do that? They used their body. They used their to market themselves, to look at my music, look how artistically creative I am. They still had to compete with other rappers and other women rappers, and they pulled themselves to the top of the heap. And I feel like they should be applauded for that.
Well, yeah, because I wanted to just kind of get your thoughts on this, because I do struggle with, you know, I was raised a certain way, certain class mm-hmm. privilege, all this stuff. So I do struggle with this politics of respectability sometimes, right? Mm-hmm. When I'm looking at booty cheeks on booty cheeks on booty cheeks. But then I'm just like, but then I remember, you know, I'm sitting here as a teenager, Snoop's first album, I'm singing right along. And, you know, you think about some of those lyrics, it's like, what in the world?
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Biggie is, you know, everyone who knows me knows that Biggie is my favorite rapper of all time. It's like, Biggie had some things on his first album, you know, Tupac had some things on his album. I mean, exactly. You go down the list of male rappers and all of them talk about explicit, dare we say, vulgar topics, but they're never framed in that way because they're not women and they're not Black women. So when Megan Thee Stallion or even Cardi B or Little Kim, right, you remember her first mm-hmm. album, you know, when they were talking about it, it's like, oh my goodness, how dare they? It's like, well, they're expressing themselves the same way their male counterparts are, and as you said, they're making this money the same way everyone said, go out and do it. Don't just mm-hmm. sit on your tail and wait for someone else to sort of bring you the American dream. Grab it. And I mean, these women are grabbing it.
Absolutely.
And it's creating, I think, a certain level of discomfort, not just with conservative Republicans that are in the video, but I think some Democrats and Black folks and upper middle class Black folks as well. Okay, so as with this and everything else, we'll continue to think about what's in it for us. Okay, so shifting gears quite dramatically, I wanted to get your thoughts on Darnella Frazier. And we know, and this is the young woman who filmed George Floyd's murder, she received a special citation from the Pulitzer Committee. So we know that lots of journalists get Pulitzer Prizes every year around this time. The board said that she was honored for, quote, courageously recording the murder of George Floyd, a video that spurred protests against police brutality around the world, highlighting the crucial role of citizens and journalists' requests for truth and justice, end quote. And so Frazier was only 17 when she recorded George Floyd's fatal encounter with Minneapolis police officer Derek Chauvin on Memorial Day of last year. And so I think what broke my heart, Pat, was when we saw the trial of Derek Chauvin, which, you know, frustratingly, so many people kept calling it the George Floyd trial. It's like, well, George Floyd's not on trial because he was murdered by Derek Chauvin. But when Frazier told jurors that there were nights that she stayed up apologizing to George Floyd for not doing more and not physically intervening and saving his life. And so I feel like I've been trying to keep her in my thoughts and my prayers just because this trauma, as you said, that she's experienced at such a young age. The world knows about George Floyd because of Darnella Frazier. And so that weight and that burden and that responsibility that she's taken quite seriously has just been so much for me to process. And I wasn't anywhere near that circumstance. What are you feeling about this honor? Do you think that it's a good thing that the Pulitzer Committee actually recognized her and acknowledged her? Or do you think that citizen journalism is not, in this particular instance, the same thing?
I think it is. And I think even accidentally so, citizen journalism it exposed a lot of ills in our society right now. The things that are the civil rights movement was going through, and they were saying police brutality, and people didn't see it. Until they started coming to, started filming the beatings on of the civil rights movement, the water hoses and the dogs. That's when white people started to realize, oh, this is brutal. This is heinous, and I don't want to be a part of that. And that's when the movement started actually gaining traction. I feel like even with Darnella Frazier, in a sense, it's a way of showcasing the brutality that's going on within our communities. But I feel, and I get emotional every time I think about it, because I too think about what she says on when she was on the witness stand and how she couldn't help him, because you're actually watching a man down. To me, that is the most, to watch somebody not just die, but to be murdered. And you're 17 years old. I mean,
yeah. And I think that's the piece I keep trying to remember. It's not, I stumbled on a dead body, right? This isn't, no. I turned a corner, I saw a man who had been shot. He's on the street. This is, I sat there while all these people around me were like, what is happening? Why is he doing this? And she knew that something in her spirit moved her to document this. But knowing also, you know, at 17, she knows what this world is. Even though she's a child, she knows that had she intervened, she could have ended up dead too. Like, mm-hmm. that is a reality that Black people know in this country. But the guilt that she has articulated so eloquently, and the sadness of being part of this larger story is something that I feel like I want to just keep sending her, like, energy, just to thank her for her bravery. Because it's bravery, right? I mean, at any point, he could have turned around and aimed his gun at her.
I remember when George Floyd's funeral, and then they had that moment of silence for that 8:40 or 9 minutes, whatever it was. And I remember, like, after about 3 minutes, and I just started crying, because I was like, 3 minutes is long to be in silence, right? And just watching a funeral. And I was like, someone is on your neck. Somebody is killing you. And I can't even imagine what it's like to be there witnessing a murder.
Well, you know what that reminded me of is when Sean Bell, for those of you, for our listeners who are from New York City, I mean, it made sort of national news, but he was the young man, 23 years old, who was killed the night before his wedding. This was in November of 2006 by undercover police officers. And I remember they shot a total of, I think it was 50 rounds at him. And I went to a protest after he was murdered, and I think Sharpton was leading the protest, but he asked us to count to 50 as we marched. And I think I got to maybe 4 before I just lost it, right? So it's like, recognizing this idea of time. And I think that's what's so interesting, that COVID has made time such a warped space for so many people. It's like, it's taffy, you know, it's really long or can be quick. And for thinking about Darnella Frazier and all these people who have had these interactions with the police, these like split second interactions that have just made the circumstance just elongated, like their lives now are so much longer. So moving on from that, which I think we're going to have to sit in for quite some time, because
oh yeah, that doesn't go away. And
no,
I'm like you too. I wish that young lady so much love and light, because going forward, that's a part of her now. That's a part of her history, her life. So yeah, that is really deep, and I'm glad that she was honored for that, but I still feel like the trauma that she's going to experience going mm-hmm. forward is,
far exceeds the Pulitzer.
Exactly. Yeah.
Far exceeds the Pulitzer. Well, speaking of people who were acknowledged, this is a story out of West Point, Mississippi. And the two Black students, Ikeria Washington and Layla Temple, who were named the 2021 valedictorian and salutatorian for West Point High School. And they have something that's called like a weighted GPA. So that means they've taken honors and AP classes, and they were the valedictorian salutatorian. And then all of a sudden, when it was announced at the awards ceremony, two white parents immediately called the school district and they called the principal. There were apologies that were made. A counselor took the fall and said, oh, you know, I made a mistake in calculation. And so they granted the four of them the salutatorian, valedictorian titles and let the four of them speak at the graduation. But Ikeria and Layla won based on the calculation of the quality point GPA, and that is how you give extra weight to AP classes and dual credit classes. And the two other students were finishers based on unweighted GPAs, which I don't believe in unweighted GPAs, because if you take underwater basket weaving and, you know, some nonsensical class, and I'm taking AP calculus and AP chemistry, we aren't the same. You know, like, mm-hmm. if you're taking, like, you know, a cute little quasi-science class and I'm in AP physics and we both get an A, we don't have the same grade point average. So on graduation night, all four students delivered their speeches at a ceremony at the Coliseum. So this type of story makes my blood boil as an educator, as someone who has seen this happen time and time again to Black students, Black people with excellence. All of a sudden, when it's a Black person, it's like, well, let's just share the title. It's, I'm not trying to put people's business in the street, but this has happened to people very, very near and dear to me in my family and my friend set, where they have gotten the honor. And then all of a sudden the institution feels the need to change the rules, essentially mm-hmm. move the goalposts, yeah. which we're so accustomed to. But the fury that I feel for taking this away from these two Black women, Black girls who worked so hard and took hard classes to get it. And now we got to give it to some, you know, slack jawed yokels who didn't even do the coursework to become equal, but they still get it. And even though the story is out of Mississippi, I still feel like this is a story that we could tell in New York City. We could tell the story in LA. It's not a Southern story. I don't want to put this on the Southerners. So what are your thoughts? you know, because I think some people would say, like, oh, well, you know, that's it. Of course they're doing that in Mississippi. It's backwards. And I'm like, no, as Malcolm X said, anything south of the Canadian border is the U.S. South. And so people behave as such. So I think I'm, as an educator, I'm so angry because we know how hard, especially in high school, certain students work by taking all these hard classes to get to that next level.
Right. So, and I agree with you. You take AP, you calculus, you take an courses like that. They are more the strenuous,
rigorous.
Rigorous than they than a class on the advanced gym. But
dodgeball 2.0.
I mean, you can get hit in the face, but it still ain't calculus. You know what I'm saying? But this is the point that I would have done that, but I think that the mothers of the Black children, and I feel like they have a right, because they didn't know. Then when they came to the ceremonies, they had them two valedictorians, two salutatorians. But I feel like they should have talked to them, and also I feel like to put the school on blast, to put, like, these girls are rightfully and explain it to people. Okay. Yes, we've given right. this to these white students, or we give it to these other students. I'm not going to even make it a case about race. We're giving it to these other students, but these students here, this is the reason that we originally, and I feel like this going forward, we should use this as our criteria going forward, mm-hmm. because it's a better criteria to go by. But I feel like it should be understood. And also we should talk to you, like, these valedictorian and then the other ones that didn't originally win, you should understand, oh yeah, you got it, you got the score, but it's not
your pre-algebra helped you out. Yeah, versus exactly. The girl who took calculus
there, exactly, we go. Yeah, we you got to understand, apples to apples, this is not apples to apples,
and sometimes it's apples to filet mignon, and here
exactly.
we
exactly. And so I feel like that I feel like they could have handled it a better way, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. but I do absolutely agree that the girls, that the Black women, the young women that originally won those two awards should be singled out for what they've accomplished.
Right. Well, shout out to Ikeria Washington and Layla Temple, and best of luck in your future endeavors. Okay, so Pat Brown, speaking of future endeavors, what is next for you?
I'll be a writer on the ESPYs coming up in July. So that is wonderful.
Congratulations.
If anybody that knows me knows that I'm a big sports fan. I played collegiate basketball in college. And so writing comedy for sports is a dream job.
Yes.
And that is absolutely wonderful.
Who's hosting the ESPYs?
Captain America, the new black Captain America.
Oh, Anthony Mackie.
Anthony Mackie, yes. He's hosting it this year. So
that's fantastic. Oh, yes. I'm so excited. Are you still doing stand-up?
I am doing stand-up, but slowly. Because I've got a lot of writing gigs coming up for me. And for me, I want to talk about what's been going on in the pandemic. And so it's like going from zero. It's coming from ground zero to trying to create something. So, I just feel like the old material is not something I want to talk about anymore. I mean, it's just like, you know, it feels like 20 years ago.
Time has changed us. Loss has changed us. Some of us have discovered resiliency we didn't know we had. Other folks have had to just recognize that, like, their squad is either amazing or shallow. Like, I think I've been calling it my renaissance.
But you know, like, what this
I just feel like I've been going through just a personal renaissance during COVID.
Even some white people understand that there's a turning point that we're going through now as a society. And so I feel like I can't talk about the old things anymore. I think it's too important. Our jobs as comedians is too important now to just talking about, you know,
yogurt for breakfast or whatever.
Exactly. Yeah.
You're just, you know, in a different place professionally, just grinding and working. And it's just so nice to see, literally see how hard work and obviously a sprinkle of good talent creates this really incredible journey where you get to do what it is that you love, which is writing, and writing for the ESPYs. So shout out to everyone who's going to watch the ESPYs. Just know when you're cracking up at a joke, it's probably a Pat Brown joke. Promise us that you'll come back and visit us another time on What's in It for Us?
That is the easiest promise I can possibly keep, other than the fact that I will be gay.
Yes, and hey, happy Pride Month. Thank you for listening to What's in It for Us. If you liked what you heard, please give us a 5-star review and subscribe to the show wherever you listen to your podcasts and share it with everyone you know. Please email all questions, suggestions, and compliments to podcasts@thegrio.com. The What's in It for Us podcast is brought to you by The Grio and executive produced by Blue Talusma and co-produced by Abdul Kadus, Antonio Thompson, and Taji Senior.